Welcome, everybody. So glad to be with you all this morning. Thank you so much for tuning in and joining Tremont Church for our time of worship and just the joy of being together this morning. We're going to walk through some of our regular things. There'll be some announcements here in just a moment. We're going to enjoy a time of song and worship together. And then I'll be sharing with you from the book of Luke. Luke chapter 5 today is where we're going to be. And discussing discipleship and some of the principles of discipleship that we see Jesus lay out in the calling of his 12 disciples, some of the early disciples. That's where we're going to be this morning. And then hopefully you've had a heads up and have had the opportunity to prepare, but we are planning to enjoy a time of communion with the Lord's Supper after the sermon this morning. It's going to flow nicely off of what we're going to see and the challenges that we're going to receive in the message. And so it'll be just good for us to take that time of remembrance and reflection and meditation at the end of the service. So if you haven't already had the opportunity to put those things together, if you want to go grab a few crumbs and something to drink by the time we get there, at the end of the service, we'll have communion together. At this time, we're going to pray, and then we'll go over to announcements with Wendy. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you so much that you have brought us together once again in this unique way, using technology, that we get to share with each other's lives, that we get to have communion with you and with one another through your Spirit. Thank you so much for your word that you have preserved for us, that continues to guard our hearts and minds and direct us to yourself. Thank you for the truth that you have preserved for us in that way. And I pray that we would submit to your leading, your instruction, your will in our lives. We love you so much, God. I pray that you would bless each household and each individual right now, that you would give them courage and strength, that you would give them perseverance in faith and in good works, that we would be on your mission, about your work, not solely focused on ourselves or even just our own families, but that we would, through relationship with you, through love, that we would reach out to the world around us. God, may you lift us up this morning, especially for those who maybe have suffered in some way, who have been challenged and tested and stretched, sometimes feeling even beyond their capacity. God, may this be a moment of rest, a moment of rejuvenation, a moment of strengthening in their lives as they put their faith in you and grow in faith in you. We love you so much, God. You are good. We bless your name. In your name, amen. Let's go over to announcements with Wendy.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining Tremont Church this morning on our live streaming service. If you are in need of food, or you can visit our food pantry on Monday mornings at 8:30 a.m. If you would like to support our food pantry, we accept donations of non-perishable food or cans and bottles. Please contact the church office to arrange a drop-off time. If you are planning to order the next discipleship guide for the Gospel Project, we need to know by Wednesday. So please email Megan at megcokendorfer@gmail.com and put Gospel Project in the subject line. Or if you prefer, you can also purchase the latest study in the mobile app of your device. Look for the Gospel Project in the App Store. Check out our online lessons on our YouTube channel, Tremont Youth, for our teens out there. They are hosting lessons live on Sundays at 6:30 p.m. or Wednesdays at 7:30 p.m. If you would like to receive our weekly bulletin, which has all of our latest updates as well as upcoming sermon information, please email tremontchurch@gmail.com and ask to be put on the bulletin list. Check out our website for the latest videos, announcements, and recommendations at tremontchurch.com or on Facebook, facebook.com/tremontchurchpdx. Thank you.
Well, hello, everybody. I'd like to invite everyone to join us in worshiping our Heavenly Father at this time. And like I have been saying each week, even though we are not together physically, we are together in spirit as the body of Christ. So please join us in worshiping the Lord, singing, "Here I am to worship," and I hope that's why you are here today, is to worship.
Step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you, hope of a life spent with you. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am. Altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious and heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth, became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Amen. The next song we're going to sing this morning is called "Awesome is the Lord Most High."
Great are you, Lord, mighty in strength. You are faithful, you will ever be. We will praise you. Offer every want the world to know. We will trust you when you call our name. Where you lead us, we follow all the way. Raise your hands, all your nations, shouting God, all creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together, for now and forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Awesome is the Lord Most High. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Raise your hand. Shout to God, all creation, how awesome is the Lord Most High. We will praise you together, for now and forever. How awesome is the Lord Most High. How awesome is the Lord Most High.
Amen and hallelujah. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest friend. On His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, the weak made strong in the Savior's love. Storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. His oath is covenant, His blood, support me in the whelming flood, when all around my soul gives.
the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Amen. Christ is our solid rock.
Sanctuary, pure and holy.
Thank you for praising the Lord with us today. And now let's go back to Pastor Nathan.
Oh, we don't have the PowerPoint. Hello, everyone. Oh, so glad that you're with us this morning. I hope you've enjoyed our time of song together and just worshiping the Lord. I'm thankful that we're able to do that still and have that blessing and gift. Well, this morning I'm going to be sharing with you from Luke chapter 5, so you can go ahead and turn over there. We're going to break it into two chunks that fit together in theme. I'm not trying to leave scripture out or you know, skip anything in a manipulative sense, but you will see that we skip a section of Luke chapter 5 in the middle here, and that's because we get a different account of Jesus interacting with someone with leprosy and a paralytic person, so there's some extra stories thrown in the middle of the context that we're going to be looking at today, which is centered around discipleship and a call to discipleship. So here we're going to see Jesus interacting with his disciples and giving a call of discipleship to them. Now, on your screen, as we travel, go along with the notes, what you're going to see is on each slide there is a key thought, a key idea in the title section, which comes directly from the discipleship. Discipleship guides. So if you're someone who's been following along with the discipleship guides at home, that comes right out of your booklet, and you'll recognize it as you go on with the week and do your study. After that, you'll find a few bullet points on each slide, which are my thoughts and some things that I see and am trying to pull out of this passage for us to clearly see. And particularly this morning, I want to focus in on some core foundational principles of discipleship that weren't just true in its original context for the disciples there at the time who are being called, but are still true for you and I today. And so I want to draw those out for us. Certainly, this is not going to be exhaustive. We are not going to be defining everything that it could possibly mean to be a disciple or a follower of Jesus Christ. But these are some foundational principles that Jesus lays out right at the very beginning of the discipleship relationship that he develops with these guys that he surrounds himself with. And in fact, just a moment ago, Vic and I were talking about this unique part of the disciples' lives, these early days of them being called. And it strikes me that Jesus consistently starts with simple things at the beginning of our relationship with him, a simple call to faith. Now, it is big in our lives at the moment. It is often extremely challenging, perhaps even seems to be the most difficult choice that we're making at the time. And yet, as we're going to see in our passage here in just a moment, an example like Peter, Simon in our passage, or Peter, the disciple of Jesus, he's called to follow Jesus, which was a big request in the moment. He was going to give up his livelihood. He was going to change his walk of life completely. And yet, from our vantage point here today as Christians in 2020, we look back and go, He had no idea the invitation that he was receiving and the adventures that he was going to go on and the things that he would see and the challenges that he would experience in his walk with Jesus Christ. And even the way that the world would look back and see him later as a champion of faith, as a teacher and pillar and instructor of the church. We don't see that in his mind or coming across in our passage at the time. And I think this is true for your and my lives today, that we too receive a simple call of faith by Jesus. At some point, in some way in our lives, we hear that call, we respond to it with just the beginning little seeds, the little kernels of faith that God has given to us. And from there, then the door is flung open that we begin to grow deeper, not only in study, but also in obedience and practice. And then God continues to challenge us. He challenges our thoughts. He challenges our worldview, our processing of the world. And we're brought deeper and deeper in relationship with the Lord. Even through our stumblings and failures, God uses these things as ways of creating depth in our understanding and increasing our faith. Well, let's go ahead and pray, and then we'll dive into the passage. Again, it's broken into two chunks, and we're going to read them both together this morning in Luke chapter 5. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank you so much for calling us together. We thank you for your word, which is the bedrock, is the foundation of our understanding and our faith. So we thank you for the truth that you have preserved for us, all that you have said and done and revealed about yourself. I pray that we would submit our hearts and minds to you and to your word, that we would not lean on our own understanding as you have taught us not to do, but that we would trust in you and that you are far bigger, are beyond our thoughts and understandings, that your ways really are for our good. They are right and true and consistent. We love you, God. I pray that you would be glorified, that you would reign supreme as we worship you this morning and as we walk in obedience to you. Pray that you would use our lives and our testimonies as a witness to the world around us, our households, our friends and family members, the people that we come in contact with, the new people that you bring into our lives. Lord, may we be faithful to you as we continue to work out our faith with fear and trembling. Thank you, Lord. We love you. Amen. Okay, we're going to be in Luke chapter 5, starting right away, and I'm actually going to go ahead and read starting in verse 1. I know on your screen it says starting in verse 3, and really when we come to the content, that's where we're going to zero in. But for context, let's go ahead and back up to the beginning of the chapter. We read here, "Now it happened that while the crowd was pressing around him and listening to the word of God, he was standing by the lake of Gennesaret." Now this is Jesus that we're talking about. "And he saw two boats lying at the edge of the lake, but the fishermen had gotten out of them and were washing their nets. And he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little way from the land. And he sat down and began teaching the people from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, 'Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch.' Simon answered and said, 'Master, we worked hard all night and caught nothing, but I will do as you say and let down the nets.' When they had done this, they enclosed a great quantity of fish, and their nets began to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat for them to come and help them. And they came and filled both of the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw that he fell down at Jesus' feet, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For amazement had seized him and all his companions because of the catch of fish which they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not fear. From now on, you will be catching men." When they had brought their boats to the land, they left everything and followed him. Now we're going to skip down and pick up again at verse 27. Read verses 27 through 32 here. After that, he went out and noticed a tax collector named Levi sitting in the tax booth. And he said to him, "Follow me." And he left everything behind and got up and began to follow him. And Levi gave a big reception for him in his house. And there was a great crowd of tax collectors and other people who were reclining at the table with them. The Pharisees and their scribes began grumbling at his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" And Jesus answered and said to them, "It is not those who are well who need a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance." Let's stop there and let's just pray and thank God for his word once again. Lord, we thank you that you have preserved this for us. Thank you for what we get to see now through your word. Help us to apply it and put it into practice in our lives. Help us to see clearly the principles that you're demonstrating and laying out here for your disciples and for us. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Just want to take these chunk by chunk. So we'll walk through it in three different pieces. First, starting with verses 3 through 7 here. This first half of the story of Jesus at the seaside. For interest's sake, you might note that Luke here is the only one in the Gospels who refers to this place as the lake of what's it called? What does he call it? Gennesaret. The Lake of Gennesaret. Most of the time in the New Testament, we read of this place as what we know of as the Lake of, or the Sea of Galilee, which was the Hebrew term for it. And then later on in history, it becomes known as the Sea or the Lake of Tiberias, which is more of the Roman influence. But here, sandwiched in between, Luke is the only guy who refers to it as the Lake of Gerasenet, which is, it's a derivative from a Greek name that region had for a while. But this is what we know of as the Sea of Galilee, that sea up on the Jordan River towards the north of Israel, deepest lake in the world as far as elevation of where it sits, well below sea level, that place where Jesus and his disciples spent so much time around that region, ministering to the cities and towns in the area. We know that several of the disciples were from that region and lived in the villages and towns, including Bethsaida, around the Sea of Galilee. And here again, we find a story of Jesus going down to the seashore, and he has a group of people that have gathered around him. He's teaching and preaching. He's speaking to them. And after a while of speaking, he takes some kind of a break, and it tells us that he notices a couple of boats down on the shore. They're being cleaned up for the day. It was the tradition, the common practice in that day, as best as I understand it from reading, that most fishermen did their fishing in the evening, at nighttime, that it was easier, that many of the fish are more docile during that time, they're closer to the surface, and they did their fishing using nets, and so that made it easier for them to gather them together and to catch them. And so they're already at the end of their time. It's now morning, and they're cleaning up everything, getting done with their work day. And so Jesus sees that these boats are available, are open, and that the men who had been working in them are off cleaning their nets. And it tells us that he climbs into one. It's owned, it's operated by Simon, who we know as Peter. And so he gets in and asks him to push off from shore, and then he begins to teach once again from inside the boat. Now, there's been lots of commentators and scholars who have thought about this and posed questions over the years. Quite a few of them say that he is knowledgeable enough to use this like an amphitheater type situation, where he is speaking from the boat and he's using the water and the raised banks as a way of helping his voice travel to the crowd of people. Oftentimes, scholars will say maybe he just needed a break and a little bit more space. It tells us specifically here at the beginning of our little passage that they've been crowding around him, that some of your translations may say that they've been pressing in on him. So the crowd just keeps pushing and moving him closer to the bank. And eventually, to get some space, he gets into the boat and asks to be put out. And at least then he can have some breathing room and people can see and hear a little better. We don't know exactly what his motivation is, but we do see that he is then able to turn this into a teachable moment. So my first question that I want to ask, it's up here on the screen for you, is what was Jesus teaching from the boat? What has he been talking about all day? The specific scholarly answer is, I don't know. However, there's some clues from the New Testament that we would be wise to have in the back of our minds. One, a little bit earlier in Scripture, a little bit earlier in the New Testament, we have the accounts of John the Baptist, which we've been going through over the last few weeks, and we know that Jesus picks up this message that John had been sharing, a call to repentance. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Also in the New Testament, we're told numerous times that as Jesus traveled that area, that he preached the gospel. Well, what was the gospel? Jesus wasn't specifically using his own name and saying, I have come to be the Messiah. We don't think that was specifically what he was saying. But again, he was picking up the message that John had been sharing, which is get ready, because the Messiah who has been prophesied, he is coming. He is coming in your time. He is in your midst. And this is a time of repentance. This is a time of renewal with the Lord. This is a time of preparation that you need to be ready for the work that God is going to do. The prophesied atonement of God, that he would provide a lasting sacrifice, a lasting path of redemption and restoration, cleansing of our sin, that would last, that would be durable, that would continue, that wouldn't be like the old sacrifices that we once used, that were just temporary and that we had to do time after time, every time that we sinned, every time, every annual festival we would have to engage in. But know that the Messiah would make a way for real lasting salvation in God. These are the kinds of things that Jesus was preaching and teaching and explaining to the people. Sometimes he did that in veiled ways. We know that many times in the New Testament, he used the tool of parables, kind of wise sayings and stories that illustrated a point, got across a moral, a value, a teaching of understanding, and that sometimes he used those in extra difficult ways. He didn't want everybody to catch on to all of the implications, all of the understanding at that moment. And so Jesus often used parables. Well, after he's done teaching for a little bit, he makes this request. Actually, the way that it's written in your scripture is it's spoken as a command. He emphatically tells Simon, put out the boat into the deep water and put down your nets. Let's go fishing again, is what he says. He says this as a command, not merely a request. That doesn't mean that it was necessarily harsh or cruel sounding or gruff in his voice. But he's not simply saying, hey, Simon, do you think we ought to? Or do you feel like it? Or wouldn't it be fun? No. Jesus has a point. He has made his decision. He has a choice. And he's going to get across something. And so he tells Simon to do something for him. My last point here is that a disciple of Jesus trusts the word of God more than their own experience and behaves accordingly. This is the big principle that I see coming out of this. Our beginning call here is that Jesus calls his disciples to trust his leading. And I'm putting it this way, that even still today, one of the foundational principles of your and my faith as people who claim to be followers of Jesus. What does that mean for us? What sets us apart from just somebody who wanders into a church building or grew up going to Sunday school and so has some sort of cultural affinity to Christianity or to the neighborhood church or something like that? What's the difference between just being a church goer or someone who thinks that Jesus is a better idea than the other religious options out there? What makes us real disciples, real followers of Jesus? Well, one of the foundations is we choose to put our faith in him in such a way that we trust God's word over everything else, including our own experience. Now, sometimes I think those of us, even in the church, at least folks I run into, they get that backwards. And they tend to place their own experience over the Word of God. And instead of being moldable and changeable themselves and changing their view of the world, we often in sociological circles, we call that a worldview, the way that we look at and interpret the world and experiences around us. Instead of taking that through the filter of the Word of God, instead of seeing the world through the truth and the understanding of God, they take the Word of God and run it through the filter of their own experience and say, well, I don't think that. I don't feel that way. My culture says this. I've never seen that happen. Or, boy, you know, miracles are too big for me to accept. Or that's too big of a challenge. Or, boy, they must not have been very enlightened there. Jesus must not have understood the world very well, because today we know such and such. They take the Word of God and try to press it through their own experience, through their own understanding, and they lose the transforming power of the Word of God. So, this first principle I want to lay out to you is we put God's Word first. We trust Him and therefore His Word above even our own experiences. Let's move on to the second half of that particular story. So they press out, and they Jesus tells Simon to put down his nets and go fishing again. Well, there's a result from that. They have an overwhelming successful fishing trip. In fact, they are overwhelmed by what's going on. There's so many fish that their nets begin to break underneath the load. And I kind of skipped it here. I love this response that Simon has to the command that Jesus gives him. This response that shows a beginning level of faith, right? It says that Simon wasn't so sure about this, but let me find it again. Verses, what is it, 8 and 9 here? Nope. Yep. Get to the right place. He says, I will do as you say and let down the nets. So he says, we've been working all night. We've already done our fishing. And verse 5, Simon answered and said, Master, we worked hard all night and caught nothing, but I will do as you say. When we put God's word first, it isn't that we're going to ignore our own experience, our own areas that we feel comfortable and in charge and even somewhat of experts or have history, have a pattern of experience. We can't just deny that sense within us. It's not like that just magically goes away and we ignore it. But rather, like Simon here, through respect and honor and trust in God, we respond to him and say, look, I don't get it. I don't know what you're doing. It doesn't fit with my experience, but I'll do it your way because you say so. And when they do that, they have this overwhelming response. The fish are breaking the net. There's tons of them. In fact, it tells us that they even have to call over their buddies. And this is when we find out here and a little bit later that John and his brother are actually partners with Simon. In fact, very likely they probably grew up in the same town, the same village together, if not very close to each other, where they kind of partner, they share in this business as fishermen. And in another place here at, verse 10 here, it mentions that John and his brother are the sons of Zebedee. In another passage talking about them being called by Jesus, says that they were in the boat fishing with their father Zebedee. So it's been passed down. They do this all together as a community, as a family, as a team. They call that boat over and they have to help. And there's so many fish that they catch that both of these little vessels, these little old-fashioned fishing boats, both of them begin to sink because there's so many stinking fish in their nets and load here. It's absolutely awing to them, especially because of Simon's expertise. This isn't the way it's supposed to work. This isn't how it works for generations. This isn't how we do it. We go fishing at night because that's when we catch the most fish. That's when it's the easiest. That's when we're the most successful. That's when we're the most profitable. That's how we do it, Lord. And yet when he submits his experience, his understanding, his view of the world to the truth of God, what God is able to do with him is amazing, even though it's still very superficial here. It's just fish in a boat, right? It's just the same kind of thing he's been doing for years, but with a twist on it that he recognizes. And that's where I want to go with this. Jesus is teaching them, and we'll get to this statement here at the end of the passage in just a moment, but Jesus is teaching them to be fishers of men is our general point. But I want to draw into this for a moment. Through this experience, Simon's, the eyes of his heart, his spiritual eyes are opened that little bit more, that little grain of faith that God has given to him begins to sprout beyond just saying, okay, I'll obey you because I respect you, because you're a rabbi, because you're a prominent person, or because I'm interested in what you have to say. He goes beyond that to now, this shocking experience shows him there's something deeper. Simon understood that there was a deeper point to this experience. And we see that in verses 8 and 9 here in how he speaks. He says, but when Simon Peter saw that, being this load of fish and what was going on and even the boats beginning to sink and just the overwhelming amount, he fell down at Jesus' feet saying, go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. This experience, as a spiritual experience, opened his eyes to his own fallen condition. That in himself he was a sinful man, that he could not measure up to the holiness and perfection and power and wisdom and glory of this one before him, the Messiah, the Savior, the Jesus of the world, the God of the universe. Now, I don't know how much of that exactly he understood in this moment, but he definitely saw his own sinfulness in the light of God's holiness. When you and I experience that, when we get a proper perspective of the self, the person of who we are, we understand that we are fallen, that we are woeful creatures. In the words of Isaiah the prophet, he says, woe am I, I am unclean, I am a man of unclean lips, O Lord. And God gives Isaiah the vision of him purifying him. You might remember in Isaiah's vision that an angel comes to him with a lump of coal, a lump of charcoal from the fire of God's altar, and brings it to him and places it on his lips. Now, this is a vision. He's not being tormented. He's not being hurt. But it's this sign of purifying, of receiving the purifying call and grace of God. Simon saw that he was a sinner, that he could not measure up, and his sense was, I shouldn't even be in your presence. This proper perspective of ourselves is absolutely important. It's paramount in our lives. So often we want to change the gospel to be something where it's a rescue from our circumstances, where somehow God is just one that when I feel bad about things, when things aren't going my way, that then God in his power steps in to make my life all better. And it is absolutely true that God is gracious and loves to do good things and give good gifts to his children. He likes to intervene in our lives. He likes to change our circumstances. He does not promise that he will change, certainly not all of our circumstances, or that he will make any one specific thing in life better or the way that we hope for or want. What he does promise is that he will be with us, that he will change us, that he will open our eyes and help us to see and understand and walk in the way of truth and grace, that he will change our perspective. Sometimes we try to take the conviction out of the gospel, And the truth is that each and every one of us need to come to this place where we see ourselves through God's eyes, that we see our sin and its destruction and the death that it brings in our lives clearly, so that we can rightly contrast that with the holiness and power and grace, the majesty of God Himself. And in that place, we are able to submit. We are able to really trust God as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as the supreme authority in our lives and in all of creation. We dare not preach a gospel to one another, to the world around us, that somehow seeks to circumvent the awfulness, the weightiness of recognition of our sin, in hopes that we can just skirt people past the bad feelings and to not feel bad and to just get to happier days, or just the love and the kindness and the joy of Christ. If people do not walk through repentance and the woefulness of sin first, they do not rightly experience the fullness and grace and transforming power of the Lord. So, Simon definitely sees that there's a deeper thing at work here. He sees his own sin. And the last point I want to draw out here is, I wrote it as, motivated by relationship. A disciple is called to service and not to sentencing. I would reference places like Romans 8:1 that says, now in Christ there is no longer condemnation for those who love the Lord, for His children. And the idea here is that through faith, through the transforming work of God, which is motivated by relationship, God desires to have a relationship with us, to have the separation, the boundary, the gulf of sin removed, so that the relationship that was designed between God and man might be restored. Not only holistically for all men, for all people, but for us individually. And so God is motivated by restoring this relationship, by bringing back together, by claiming back to Himself what rightfully belongs to Him, this relationship that He desires. Motivated by that, He calls us to service, to actually do something. He's not opening our eyes to our own sinfulness, to the truth of who we are and who He is, just as a way of demonstrating or laying out evidence so that we can be sentenced to judgment. Now, if we don't repent, if we don't turn to Him in faith, we will experience that kind of sentencing. The natural drive, the natural direction that our sin is going, is taking us before the throne of God to be rightly judged as He is restoring the world, as He is restoring all things to Himself. And we will put ourselves in that place of judgment, in that place of sentencing, if we do not turn to Him in faith and repentance. But God's purpose for bringing to light our sin, for convicting us, for showing us who we really are, is so that we will turn to Him in faith and then act out of obedience, that we would be brought into His kingdom, His establishment, His family, and that we would rise to the call of service, of productivity, of activeness within His household, within His kingdom. We're called to serve. Now we'll come back to that in a moment. Let's move on to kind of our second story in a sense, but really it's a continuation of Jesus calling the disciples in its original context, but also this idea of us understanding the call of discipleship. So in this the second part here, we find the encounter of Jesus meeting and calling Levi, or who we call the disciple Matthew. And it tells us right off the bat that he is a tax collector and he is about the tax collecting work right now. So it tells us that he meets him and that Levi is sitting in the tax collector booth. Probably this is one of the chambers in the gatehouse, the court. In those days there would be a city gate or multiple city gates. And then there would be a series of civil chambers, little booths, either wood or stone, little compartments, just big enough for something like a desk to be in there. And this is often where different leaders or civil people of the city would be to help people as they were coming in and out of the city do the things they needed to do. So this is where money changers would sit so that you could change whatever currency you had to whatever currency was accepted in this town or village or city. This is where somebody like someone who is in charge of justice, some sort of guard or a sheriff or that kind of idea would be in this area. Maybe someone like a scribe or a judge or someone who could be, you could go to as an advocate for you for business type situations, those kinds of things, and also where the local tax collector would sit so that you didn't have to know where to go to pay your taxes. And oftentimes because there was a tax just to enter into this town, or there were taxes collected as you were leaving the town for the things that you accomplished while you were there. Levi's a tax collector. He's sitting in the tax collector booth. He's doing tax collector stuff. And as you have probably heard in sermons and stuff through the years, tax collectors at this particular time were not regarded with kindness and joy at all. Not, you know, horribly unlike today. But particularly for the Jews, tax collectors were usually people of Jewish descent, Jewish by birth, who then had signed on with the Romans to do this task. The Romans liked to do it that way because it felt like it was easier. They liked to have local people in charge of doing the difficult work, the work that nobody liked, because it created kind of a separation between the soldiers and the people. It tended to cut down on rioting and that kind of stuff that the Romans didn't like. But the Jews did not like it because they saw it as an act of betrayal. And often the times the people choosing to engage as tax collectors, they chose to do that because they were dishonest themselves. And they would manipulate the situation, the opportunity. The Romans did not care how much money you took from people as long as they got their cut on time that they could send back to Rome, back to the emperor, back and distribute among whatever the different leaders were that were going to get a piece of that. They didn't care. And so that was oftentimes exploited, and tax collectors would charge far more than what was required and then keep that themselves as their own profit. So they were getting wealthy on the backs of their own countrymen, and just was a blatant display of selfishness and dishonesty. And so tax collectors at this time were often used as people, as a term synonymous with sin itself. To be a tax collector was seen to be a traitor and a sinner, someone who had nothing to do with God or had nothing to do with God's people. Well, Jesus interacts with this man, Levi, and he calls him. He literally, specifically calls him and says, "Come and follow me." much like he had with his other disciples, much like he had with Simon, who he said, come, follow me. Tells us that Levi does. He comes right away. He leaves what he's doing and comes to follow Jesus. We're not told what all is in his heart or what all of his motivations are. Maybe he was tired of being looked down upon. Maybe he had a sense of guilt for his own selfishness and greed and sinfulness. Maybe he thought, man, I'm way past my chance to ever do anything spiritually significant, to ever be called by a rabbi or anything like that. But here's this one who behaves, who acts, who looks like a rabbi, who is calling me. Maybe this is my opportunity. I don't know what all his motives are. But again, much like Peter was able with spiritual eyes to be awakened and notice that this experience that he was having in his own context was showing him something deeper. Likewise here, Levi seems to catch on that this is an opportunity that is too important to pass up. And he chooses to follow Jesus. I want to draw out this point from it. Really, it fits in both of these stories and even into the further context of the Gospels and still to this day, which is a disciple can come from any walk of life, whether it be the low class, working class walk of life that Simon Peter and John and some of the other disciples came from as fishermen from the hillbilly country up north, that weren't particularly seen as educated or people who would probably amount to much of anything, or whether it be someone as blatant as Matthew, Levi the tax collector, whose very choices in life, his chosen occupation, labeled him as a sinner, an outcast, someone to be avoided and despised. And everywhere in between, and even folks like you and I today, God calls from every walk of life, from every tribe, from every language, from every background. The family that you were born into, good or bad, does not determine the relationship that you have been called to with Jesus Christ. If you've been born into a family that is a mess and a disaster and hurtful and oppressive and destructive, you can rise above that through the grace of Jesus Christ and receive his call and choose a new walk of life. And if you've been born into great privilege and comfort, no wealth, no position is enough to save our souls, you need to follow Jesus Christ. And if you've been had the privilege of being born into a God-fearing Christian family that seems to have everything all together, and you've been had this wonderful heritage of faith passed on to you, that's wonderful, and I hope that gives you some clarity. I hope that it gives you some perspective, but it is not enough to save your soul. You too will need to choose to come and follow Jesus of your own volition. I want to hit this thing, I put it in the notes as the doctor's misdiagnosis. And now, it's a bit of a play on words, so go back and look with me real quick at verses 30 and 31 here. What I mean by doctor here is, doctor is often a term used for, in my passage, what shows up as scribes, okay? So they're scribes and Pharisees, and they begin grumbling at this party that Matthew throws in celebration I suppose, in excitement, maybe in a ministering opportunity of, hey, I want my friends to meet this guy that I've just met. I want them to hear what he has to say and this exciting grace that he offers. But Levi throws a party, a dinner party of sorts. He's got a bunch of people together, a bunch of friends. Somehow the scribes and Pharisees gather around too. I don't know if they were invited or if they just pressed into the situation. But they begin grumbling to Jesus' disciples and saying, how come you guys sit down and eat with these sinners, with tax collectors and sinners? You know, most people avoid people like this. Why would you do anything like this? So these doctors of the law have this diagnosis of you're doing the wrong thing here. You don't understand how spiritual things are supposed to work. You don't understand the kind of people that you're supposed to be. You claim to be following after God in a deeper way. You claim to have set your lives to follow God. What are you thinking here? This isn't what you should be doing. Jesus, in verse 31, answers them. He answers back. He gives an explanation and says, it is not those who are well who need a physician. And I think that's just a fun play on words, personally, myself right here, of these guys who are often referred to as doctors. Yes, it would be more of the PhD type understanding, these people who are supposed to know the law. But here Jesus is using the physician language. There's a famous phrase that Jesus refers to in other places. He refers to himself when he goes back to Nazareth, and he says, you might say, physician, heal thyself, which was an old phrase, the idea of a doctor should take care of themselves, their own needs, before claiming to be able to help others. This language of physician work, and here he uses that in his answer. It's not, and he says, it's not the well people who need a physician, but the sick people who need a physician. And so he's referring to himself and his own call. And he follows that up with his last statement in verse 32 here, where he says, I have not come to call the righteous, but the sinners to repentance. So why does Jesus take his disciples into the house of a sinner to sit down and eat and drink with sinners? Because they're the whole focus. They're the very reason that he has come. He has come to call, to make a way, to heal that which is destroyed, that which is lost, that which has been corrupted. Now, specifically, he's referring to your and my hearts and lives and souls, just as he started with his disciples in giving them that glimmer, that little seed of faith, and beginning to help that to grow and to turn into something. Likewise, he is reaching out with grace to these blatant sinners and saying, you too have opportunity to receive the truth, to believe, to follow after Jesus, just as he does with you or my lives individually. But on a bigger scope, he's foreshadowing the very reason that he had come into the world, that for all people he was making a way, that they could be healed from the corruption, the sickness of the soul, the inherited sin from Adam, that condition of sin. He was going to make a way that we could be made clean and righteous before God. This is the great mission of Jesus Christ. It's still the same mission that he has us on today. And so I want to take you to this last point, which is a disciple partners in the mission of Christ. I was a little uncomfortable when I first looked at this in our discipleship guides, and you can see at the top of your screen there the lesson note that they make, which is Jesus calls his disciples to invite sinners to repent. The problem with that is he doesn't do that here. He doesn't give his disciples an invitation to call sinners to repent specifically. That's not the words that we have here in this context. We don't see that him in this passage turn to them and say, okay, guys, this is what I want you to do. And yet, it took me a little bit, but when we look at it in the broader context of what he has already done in their lives, what he has said earlier on to Simon, to Peter at the seashore, where he says, from now on, I'm going to make you a fisher of men. And as he goes through the New Testament, as he goes through the Gospels, we see that he is revealing bits and pieces of his mission, his calling, but he is passing it on to them, that they would remember, that they would learn, that they would ask questions, that they would grow deep in what he's teaching them so that they could carry it on. And that is the foundation of what discipleship is. This is why Jesus comes at this unique time in history, at least in part, is this idea of discipleship. One who chooses themselves to follow after the master, the one who knows, the one who has the experience, the one who has the relationship with God, to follow them literally, physically in their day for the purpose of taking on that leader, that rabbi's likeness as their own character, that they would be able to carry it on and pass it on to the next generation. This is the very core nature of what discipleship is, to follow Jesus, to know him in such a way that we become like him, not taking up his position of divinity, certainly, but becoming like him in all the character, in all the grace, in all the wisdom that he would enable us, that he would instill in us, that we might be able to pass it on to others. The invitation to call sinners to repent is also an invitation to call them to be disciples, to walk the same path that you and I are walking, to follow after Jesus on this incredible adventure of change. I put up a couple of references that you can check out later. I'm not going to go through them right now, but certainly places like Luke 19:10 and Matthew 28:18-20 are both familiar to us and make this idea clear to us that he is calling his disciples, that he is calling you and I as followers to continue this work of inviting people into repentance, of inviting people to discipleship. Well, let's wrap up here, and then we'll go to our time of communion. This was somebody else's writing that I liked, this missional application, so I want to share it with you and then expound it just a little bit. It says, because Jesus gave up his life for us, and we have committed to following him, we intentionally invest in others so that they might become his disciples as well. Many groups have used simple slogans, and sometimes we say that in a demeaning way because you can oversimplify in slogans or, you know, kind of become bumper sticker type Christians, and that's not what I'm promoting. That's not what I want us to do. But many groups will use something to the effect of that we should love God and love others. And this comes right from the Great Commandment. We see it used by Jesus. We see it shown all over through Scripture. This simple way of looking at things, that our relationship to God, that our walk as disciples comes down to the type of relationship we have with God directly, and then through that, the relationship that we have with others, to love God and then to love others. When we really walk after Jesus, when we put him first, when we come to understand who he is and what he's all about, when we study and put into application each one of his lessons, his teachings, his examples, we grow in relationship to him. We grow in faith. We grow in courage. We grow in spiritual strength. We grow in boldness in stepping out and doing incredible things for God. But also, it naturally calls us to have a heart of compassion, not just in social sense of social works, not just recognizing people's plight and difficulties in life, as good as and as important as that is, but that we would take on God's view of people, that they have intrinsic value as his created children, and that their souls are in need of rescue, that they are in a desperate, dying position. And unless God intervenes, unless he uses his body, his church, his people, his Christ to reach out, to call into the darkness, to show the way, to rescue, they will continue into death, just as you, each of us, would have done apart from God's intervention. He has called us to grow in relationship with him, but then to invest in others, that they too might be disciples of Jesus. So I just simply ask you, and I've been wrestling with this all week, are you investing? Not just do, I don't want to diminish prayer, but the question here is not just if you have a prayer list that you casually pray for. I know that there are some of you who are really prayer warriors who don't just casually pray for other people, not just their boo-boos and wants and desires, but for their souls and for their salvation. But you earnestly, you consistently, you're championing that cause. But for some of us, yeah, we're tender to it. We give a passing thought every now and then when it pops to mind, that kind of thing. But there's not really investment. We're not really seeking after folks that they might really believe, that they might become disciples themselves. So I ask you not to put a guilt trip on, and I don't want to be overly specific for your life, but in what ways are you putting this into practice, that you're investing in others so that they too might become disciples? I want to challenge you with that as we head into a prayer time and then head into communion, of some of these simple foundational points that we have, that we as disciples, as when we choose to follow Jesus, that we put his word, we trust his word above everything else, including our own experience. That we understand that we have been set free from condemnation, and that we don't have to be the same people that we once were. We don't have to be stuck in sin. And that because God has done this great work in our lives, that we choose to follow him, to invest in his relationship, but also to invest in others, that they too might know him. How is that going in your life? What are you doing with that? Love to hear your comments, see what you have to say about that, maybe some personal examples of what's going on. I'd love to hear some of your stories. But I'd also like us to take this discipleship relationship in our hearts and minds as we enter into a time of remembrance and reflection on Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We praise him that he has called us to salvation, that he has called us as disciples. So let me step behind me here. I'm going to, Vic's going to go grab the elements for us so that, for me anyways, so that I have them. And we'll take some time in prayer here. Every time that we come to the Lord's Supper, we want to remember specifically the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, which he does in obedience to the Father and as practical demonstration for us and as a way of us remembering what he has done. It also, at least in my life, I'm not necessarily meaning this so much for teaching, but just as a way of reflecting, for me, this is a great time to take stock, not so much from guilt. And I know sometimes maybe I highlight it that way, especially in the Corinthians 11 passage. Paul calls us to consider our own hearts, to consider where we're at with the Lord, that we might partake in a worthy manner, he says it. And that's not the only place in Scripture that talks about the living up to the calling that we have been given. But I think it's important that we reflect on who Jesus is, who he says that we are. And I don't know if you struggle with this, but I've struggled throughout my Christian life knowing the truth of who God says that I am, but not always on a day-to-day believing it in my heart, not always living up to the calling that he has given as a disciple, but always not always accepting his grace as his child. This is a good time to remember that he loves us so much that he gave himself for us in a physical context, in a spiritual context, in an ongoing sacrificial context. Jesus is still putting up with your and my foolishness and stumblings and bumblings and missteps today. And he has already secured the path. He has already provided the grace for us to seek repentance, for us to be encouraged, for us to be forgiven, for us to be lifted up out of our muck and mire and foolishness. This is a great opportunity to give him thanks and praise, to rest in him, to trust, to take in him at faith, at his word once again, that what he has begun in us, he will see to completion. And again, that his purpose, his desire, was not to show you and I our sin and our error so that he could crush us and oppress us and make us feel really, really bad before he locks us in chains and throws away the key and sends us off to hell, but rather that we might humble ourselves and repent and be restored to the boldness and strength and power of life and of relationship that he has always desired for us, has always desired to enter into with us. So I invite you, as we partake today, to consider what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ and to give praise, to give thanksgiving for what I hope and believe that he has already done in your life, and to consider how you might serve him in investing in others, that they too would be able to come to this place of communion where they could rightfully receive of the Lord the grace that he has provided. So would you pray for me, and then we'll take the elements one at a time. Lord God, we love you. I thank you for your word. Thank you for this precious time together. God, we thank you for your son, Jesus. And we thank you that he was obedient even to the cross. We thank you that he was restored again on the third day to life, that he has been resurrected into heaven to sit there at your right hand, that he intercedes on our behalf, that he is continually sending out the Holy Spirit to convict men and women and boys and girls of sin, but also to reveal the truth of who you are, and to witness, to encourage us that we now have been bought, we have been secured as your children. God, we love you so much. We pray for each one that we would repent of our sin, that we would turn away from it and go in your direction, that we would run after, that we would cling to you. Lord, now we take this bread that represents your body, which you told your disciples, and then you demonstrated in reality, would be broken, would be whipped and cut and scarred, that they would mistreat you, that they would misunderstand you, that they would rather destroy you than turn and humble themselves. God, we take this as a reminder of your great sacrifice, your demonstration of love and grace to us. We remember your broken body, and we love you. Will you take and partake of the Lord's body? Now likewise, Father, we take whatever form people are using today, we take this juice, this cup, which represents your blood that was shed on our behalf. We remember that it was very real, literal blood. But even more than that, it was the spiritual cost. It was the price of forgiveness of sin. You have long showed us that blood, that life was the demand, was the cost of sin. And we trust you that in your perfect sacrifice, as the sinless one who went to the cross as a sin offering, as a lamb on our behalf, that your sinless, perfect, righteous life, your blood, is sufficient to cover, to cleanse all of our sins. All of us here today, all who have come before, all who will come after, and every sin of our hearts, of our actions, of our attitudes, all of these things, you are more than enough to forgive, to cleanse, to restore. Lord, thank you for your blood that makes us whiter than snow. May we take of it, of this cup, not just as a ritual or an action, but in real faith, believing that you make us right, that you make us clean, that we do not have to sin because you have secured freedom for us. God, we love you. We praise you for your goodness and your grace. We receive this cup trusting that you are enough. In your name, amen. Will you drink and be blessed and graced by the Lord Jesus? Well, thank you for joining us this morning. I trust that that you'll continue, hopefully in this day, but in the days to come, that you will continue in worship, that you will continue in reflection and honoring of Jesus Christ. I hope maybe some of the little bits that we were able to draw out today both are a benefit to you personally, but maybe they've are able to open up a discussion with your household group, or maybe jump on the phone and talk to someone that you know or that you think would benefit by going back over these stories. Share these stories again with someone else. Talk about what discipleship is. Talk about what the disciples learned from Jesus. That's a great way for us to invest in others, is to not keep the truth of the gospel message quiet to ourselves, not necessarily being preachy, but just talking about what the Word of God says with a friend or a loved one, maybe with your grandkids, just going back over what story you learned today at church is a great way to bless them and open up conversation. Be well, be blessed of the Lord. We love you so much, and we look forward to when we can gather back together and give hugs and worship together physically. Have a good week, and we will see you soon.
Let us close our time of worship together by singing the doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
God bless you.